Previously on the Better Buildings Challenge Swap.
Can you feel that draft?
Wow, yeah.
I wonder if it's supposed to be putting cold air in here in December.
We supply 65% of our service area, and I dare you to find anything in here.
The Atlanta team seemed like they were very, very confident that we weren't going to be able to find much, maybe a little overconfident.
And wow.
Very hot here.
We're going to need to bring this one up.
The city of Atlanta. The city of Boston. Hosted by Maria Vargas from the U.S. Department of Energy. Two energy teams swapped.
Well, I want to start off by saying thank you so much to the Atlanta team and to the Boston team for being part of this swap. I think given the really important roles that cities play in our sustainable future, this swap is really important, not only to your cities, but to cities across the country. Let's start with Atlanta. Stephanie.
Thank you so much. I mean, this was a great competition. It's a friendly competition. And I think we got some nice takeaways that we can learn from in Atlanta. And also, hopefully, have some suggestions for you. I was particularly interested in your solar program because we're launching a solar program in Atlanta. So one of the questions that we had when we toured the rooftop facility is, why is there a gap in your solar installation? And also, why were your roofs black instead of taking advantage of some easy, making the roofs white? And did you look at green roofing?
Some of it had to do with funding. It's something that we could look at potentially filling in some of those gaps. To address your point about the white versus black rooftops in more northern climates where we tend to get more snow, we need to make sure that the rooftop is absorbing a lot of that heat as to melt off the snow earlier rather than later. White roofs are usually good in more southern or temperate or arid climates where you want to reflect as much heat as possible, but we actually want to absorb a lot because our main energy demand comes from the heating side. We just came from a really cold area, and now I'm feeling the heat in here.
Yeah, you can definitely feel it.
Which is kind of the opposite of where heat usually goes. When we were going through the airport, we noticed a lot of great things you had done there already. But what I noticed in particular, some of the heating issues within the main terminal. So when you walked in there, it was very cool at the highest level. And then as you went down the escalators towards the tram that brings you from terminal to terminal, it actually got warmer. There might be some opportunities to route some of that ventilation upwards such that you get higher temperatures at the higher points of the building, and then kind of reduces some of your cooling needs down at the lower side.
Where do you think they're actually separating? So they're taking the oil in here.
Right.
They put the waste there.
Right. So when they wash down the floors, I bet it goes into this trough. And it should be going to an oil-water separator.
That's right.
Which is a great thing.
Do you see any potential to use the separated oil from your oil and water separators in the central garage in any way?
Right now we're just separating them out, but we would like to be looking into maybe figuring out a way to use that energy to recycle it for later on.
Walking from both the McKim side and the Johnson side, the two wings, that each of the buildings had a lot of potential in terms of the use of natural light and in different ways, because one is of a different era. And I think we lose sight of this a lot of times when we're doing energy retrofits, is to remember that there's the original design of buildings, especially of those eras, had to do with the environment. So they were built, especially the McKim wing was built such that it would be in and of itself energy efficient. So to remember that as we're doing modern technological upfits to buildings.
That's great. And I think that if there's a big takeaway that we had, I think that most of the things that we found were really behavioral. Mm-hmm. And that's really a policy thing. You have that great technology in place, now you have to make sure that you're using it to its best ability. Even if that's just having a quarterly energy walk and realizing that you're doing that simultaneous heating and cooling or some of the other things that we've found over at Hemp Hill.
It's small, in when you think about it in retrospect, we spend so much time trying to work on big savings and getting ourselves as energy efficient as possible that sometimes we tend to overlook some of these smaller things. But when we step back, we can take a look at it and on secondary maybe fix some of those things with small little fixes and would help us save some money and help change the culture.
The other thing we haven't talked about that I'm interested in is the level of community support in Boston for this. I mean, you talk about bureaucratic impediments or other legislative impediments, but really the residents of the cities are going to drive this to a large degree. And we have great leadership in Atlanta with Mayor Reed, you have it with Mayor Walsh, but I wonder how that's translating to the larger community in terms of the support, because moving past where we are and implementing technology and really getting into lifestyle issues and all those kinds of things really is about how you're going to live. So what kind of community support and buy-in are you seeing?
Well, we're really fortunate in Boston. Not only do we have a very, very passionate community around energy, but we also have the leadership from Mayor Walsh, who is pushing all of us to do as much as we can with the resources that we have. And I know that Atlanta has an energy savings performance contracting initiative that's ongoing that you guys have started, and we're in the process of starting ours as well, because that's one of those issues for us, having enough financing to do all the projects, even when we know where they are and what we can do. We have to make sure that we can expand our capacity to do that from a financial perspective, and doing that energy savings performance contract will allow us to expand our capital budget by having the guaranteed savings in place.
One takeaway I got from talking with y'all is how you streamlined your procurement, and you basically have like a one-stop computer program that makes it a lot easier, not only for you on the city side, but also for the vendors who want to do business with the city. So that's something I would love to see us consider implementing in Atlanta.
The other thing I have to say, though, is that people that are coming to Atlanta are expecting this. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're concerned about the climate. They're coming to the city to have a certain lifestyle. And, you know, they don't think of it necessarily as being energy efficient, but it is a lifestyle that in and of itself is. Actually, that's some of the competition among cities, is to be better in this arena to attract people that want to live this way and are concerned about these issues.
I want to thank again the City of Boston and the City of Atlanta for being part of this swap. And I found that there was a quote that actually is inscribed here in Atlanta in front of the Georgia Aquarium. And it's a quote that says, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world." And my hat's off to all of you and the people you work with in your cities, because you really are changing the world. Thank you for being part of the Better Buildings Challenge, and we appreciate you doing the swap.
Thanks so much for having us.
Thank you, guys. Thanks.
I think the biggest takeaway is the importance of cities collaborating with one another. While it was a competition, it was all good-spirited, and we really wanted to share best practices and figure out how we can implement them at the local level. I think they gave us some good suggestions, and we'll look at, especially the airport, some of the LED lighting and the heating issues, and would love for y'all to come back in a year and check in with us and see how we're doing.
I know in the environment department, we're certainly going to take a lot of this back, and we're going to make sure that we help understand what we might be able to do in some of our other line departments.
I think one of the things that I noticed, even when just surveying our own buildings, was some of the operational adjustments we want to make in order to drive further efficiencies out of the equipment that we've made investments in.
One of the reasons I'm so excited about this swap is that there are cities and communities, large and small, all over this country who are grappling with the very same issues that Boston and Atlanta are grappling with. And I'm hoping that the learnings and the sharing that happened during this swap can be taken advantage of by people all over the country.
The cities of Boston and Atlanta, both leading communities in energy efficiency, come together to demonstrate the importance of collaboration as they work together to exchange ideas and share perspectives in the Better Buildings Challenge Swap. These cities prove there is always room to do better.